Market watchers are now gnashing their teeth. He's using Bible language, gnashing their teeth, mourning for the future of the Russian economy. They say that the decision to start the bidding at such a low valuation and the fact that the government is saying that no foreign company has expressed interest in the sale codifies suspicions that government efforts against UCOS have been purely political all along. Now, if you don't know anything about the story, read the trumpet and we'll keep you up to date on what's happening there. And we have written about this in the past, and so I won't go into the details now. But this article continues, to make matters worse, the price $3.73 billion is about equal to the cash that Gazprom, the government-run natural gas firm that seeks to become an oil giant itself, has on hand. And that makes the auction little more than a state asset grab. A state asset grab by the Putin government. Now that means the government is going to become very wealthy, and have a lot of power again. That's what it means, and that's what Europe knows, and that's what we ought to know, but more importantly, we ought to know, what does this have to do with Bible prophecy? What does it have to do with your life, your future? And it has a lot more than you can even imagine, I'm quite sure. The article continues, and I'll conclude it here. The subsidiary will almost certainly end up in the hands of Gazprom between the purchase of Neftogaz and Gazprom's nearly completed merger with Rosneft, a state oil company. Gazprom will soon be producing somewhere around 1.8 million barrels per day, about the same as super major Chevron Texaco. Well, how about that? And it's going to be run by the government. It's going to be run by the government and will empower the government. And they have a lot of oil in Russia. And you know what that means with the price of gas these days. But the article concludes, the Russian state is about to enter the petroleum big leagues with a state firm that will in time be part of every meaningful investment project in the country. The move is anti-democratic, anti-free market, violates contractual rights, and plays to the worst aspects of corporate law, transparency, and crony capitalism. In short, it's all of the bad things that have become common with Russian privatization auctions, and while no one else should be surprised, they are again. Now, I just want to read you two lines from an article I wrote January this year in our trumpet. Here's what I said. A more dictatorial Russian government is coming fast, and you need to know where it is leading. That power will be able to challenge Europe when nobody else can, including the U.S. Now, you can read that if you have the January trumpet of this year, but you can see how the trumpet is certainly very much into predicting what is coming based on Bible prophecy. Based on Bible prophecy, but Russia's single most strategic asset is oil. Oil! That's their most strategic asset, and Mr. Putin is making a move to get control of that oil. And that means the government is going to have unparalleled power. That's what it means. Russia is back on the world stage, and Europe is very nervous. And they, in turn, are making Russia nervous. But think about this for a moment. What was it that really wrecked the Soviet Union? What caused them to collapse? Well, a bad economy, a weak economy. But now Mr. Putin is correcting that problem, and I think you need not forget, or you should not forget, that he also was a leader inside the KGB when the communists were in power. So I suspect he was trained for such deals. Wouldn't you think so? Maybe he got some good training there. But at any rate, here's what's most important, is that every bit of this is fulfilling Bible prophecy. And you can prove it as it's unfolding. You can prove it. The book of Revelation puts all prophecy into time sequence. time sequence, it talks about the three woes. And I'm going to show you in a brief amount of time, but this book will have to give you a lot of the details. And I hope you'll write for it because it's free. But anyhow, the Bible talks about three woes to put this in a time frame so you can understand how it's all tied to world events, other world events. But first of the first woe talked about in the Bible means that Russia and China are a victim of that first woe. That is that's what Daniel 11 verse 44 was talking about here. When they saw this in the north and the east, it troubled them, and so they made a preemptive strike, thinking the only way to win was strike first. Well, they didn't win, certainly not to any great degree. And then the second woe is Russia and China counterattacking with this 200 million man army. That's all very clearly put in a time frame in the book of Revelation. And I'm telling you, you can prove this to yourself rather easily if you just study hard and look into this. Is that hard to believe? Well, if you understand Bible prophecy, you know that Daniel is the key to the book of Revelation, and that those scriptures I just read to you there in Daniel 11 certainly are a key to point to these three woes. You need to understand these woes, and you need to if you see how they're tied together, you can see how all of this is going to lead to the very return of Jesus Christ to this earth. It's all connected. I mean, connected directly to the return of Jesus Christ to this earth. And this is that greatest army that ever has been assembled in the history of man. Notice Revelation 9 in verse 15. It talks about these woes, and I'll start on down in verse 15 with the second woe just to tie that in a little more directly to what I've been talking about. Verse 15, and the four angels were loosed, which were prepared for an hour and a day and a month and a year for to slay the third part of men. Now this is talking about angels slaying a third part of all mankind. I believe we ought to take note of this. I believe we ought to heed what God says. Verse 16, and the number of the army of the horsemen were 200,000, and I heard the number of them. This is that 200 million man army. Sounds fantastic. Sounds like maybe you couldn't even assemble an army like that, you think? What do you think? Well, now listen, there's only one portion of the world that could field such an army. And I think that's pretty obvious. In the area of China and Russia, especially China, which has 1.2 billion people. Russia has 150 million. And of course, a billion is 1,000 million. But if you take 15% of that population, you can see how you could get an army of 200 million soldiers. And there's only one part of the world where you could get them. That really ought not to be that puzzling to us. And I mean to tell you, they're going to be engaged in the most deadly, ghoulish war that there ever has been on this earth, ever. And these are the times that we're living in. And it's getting awfully close. I mean, really, if we're in touch with reality and what's happening in the world with a proliferation of nuclear power to all of these aggressive nations, we know it's out of control. It's out of control. And the fears of both the Russians and the Europeans and these emotions that they have is really directly tied to the return of Jesus Christ to this earth. I tell you, this is wonderful news. It's sad in one sense in the short term, but all of these emotions, many of these emotions that you see in world leaders and the people in the world today are actually connected to the very return of Jesus Christ to stop it all. So that if he didn't, he said, no flesh would be saved alive. Matthew 24.